What's the publishing date?
76.
76, okay. So, and now we are, you know, 30 years later. So, you can't just stop at that book, because obviously life has moved on. So, but at the same time, there's a huge amount of material there. How does one straddle learning that material and getting modern? It's a very difficult balance, and my view on that is you must play with things. So that last problem brings out my philosophy very well. You know, no matter how much formalism there is, when you're entering a new field, try to play with something and try to own the material. And that's why playing with the foresight, tensight, getting an idea of the modes, going back to the analytics and connecting with that, you know, very powerful. And then going on to do something new, like putting a defect and seeing what that does. And then trying to connect with experiments. And it'll bring you very quickly, when you read the references, to papers as late as 2008. And if you look at some of these papers, you'll see pictures very much like your modes. So, you know, of course, I'm not trying to say this is publishable, but you're getting a window into something that is very current day research, where people are measuring these modes, breathing modes, they call it, but they are essentially localized modes on defects using Raman scattering. So, you know, right away you see some connection. So I'm kind of happy that this aspect has come out, and I hope it will stand you in good stead when faced with a lot of information, and I hope it will give you some way of attacking, you know, research finally. So I do want to say a few things about concluding this quarter and then going on to what I will do next quarter, but I don't want to finish, don't want to forget those SETs. So what I'm going to do is hand these out. I'll kind of leave the room for a few minutes and then come back and you know, pour your hearts out, say what you want to say. And try to be, give me some useful feedback here. Right. So what I want you to notice are this. So we've been looking at magnetic transport. And the main point within that was that the conductivity became a tensor. There was a response along the diagonal as well as off diagonal. And what we looked at was basically Langdon levels. So let me just remind you about that. And we said that in a magnetic field, the energy levels become quantized. Omega C is E, B, omega N, C, and the degeneracy of each level was B times A, total flux over flux quantum, which was B times A over 8C over E, and that came down to, N5 is, yeah, that's correct. And the filling factor was essentially number of electrons per flux quantum. Okay. So the picture is the following. We have a density of states as a function of energy, which is like this. And when we say mu equal to 1, we have a certain amount of flux through the system, and if we count it in units of the flux quantum, phi naught is the flux quantum, then we have some number, let's say 1,000. So if we have 1,000 electrons, each electron saturates one of the flux quanta. So that's mu equal to 1. When we say mu equal to 2, it basically means there are 2 electrons per flux quantum. Okay, and if I try to write it in units with magnetic field, this comes down to N over B times phi naught. Okay. So what you're going to see is, so we went through the integer quantum Hall effect. Yeah, sorry, question.
Well, you used some language that was kind of weird. You said the electron saturates flux quantum. And I'm also, I've got in my notes, and I don't know if I copied something down, that the height of these like delta functions is N5. So you've got like, N phi electrons in each harmonic oscillator state.
Right.
But I don't understand why the number of flux quanta gives you the number of electrons in each.
Ah, no, these are two independent things. So number of electrons you are controlling with the density, with what you are putting in.
But that's the total number, right?
Yeah, that's the total number.
Okay.
Little n is density, which is number per unit area. Okay, so little n is number of electrons per unit area. Okay, now what I'm saying is, you can do the counting. So what I'm trying to say is, the important control parameter in quantum Hall effect is the filling factor, which tells you how much of a Landau level is filled. Okay, so density is outside right now. We are not talking about density right now. Let's just talk about the magnetic field. The magnetic field decides for us this spacing. The magnetic field also decides how many states I have. This is the degeneracy.
So that's my question, why are those the same?
Which one? The number of electrons and degeneracy?
No.
They are not the same. The degeneracy is this. Do you?
That's my confusion. I can understand that we can quantize the amount of magnetic field flux, but why does that give you the number of electron states in each of those delta function peaks?
Number of states, okay, yeah. So the reason for that is, so remember how we got this degeneracy. Okay, let's try to recall. The way we got that was, here was the system. When we solved for the eigenfunctions, we found that the eigenfunctions had this structure. It was a plane wave state along x. So this is x. And along y, it was a localized state on the scale of the magnetic length. Okay? And the magnetic length is basically given by, so 2 pi L squared is pi naught. The B times 2, this is the definition of the magnetic length. L squared is it's that length such that B times 2 pi L squared encloses a flux quantum. Okay, that's how you define this length. And so L comes out to be H C over E, and this is the 2 pi becomes H bar C over E B square root. So what you see from here is as B increases, L decreases. Okay? Now the degeneracy is coming from where? It's coming from the fact that I have a fixed sample, you know, Ly, and this is Lx, and it's coming from the fact that this strip could be anywhere along y. Okay, that's the origin of the degeneracy. Now, so you basically, n phi is essentially, you know, of Ly over L, little l. So as the magnetic field increases, the magnetic length shrinks. So you can fit more of these strips within the sample. Okay, so that's what this thing is capturing. So N phi is basically capturing that degeneracy by saying it's equal to the total flux through the tube, through the sample, divided by the flux quantum. That number is the height of these. That's how many states there are in each of these Landau levels. Okay, everybody with me? Or you have questions? Okay, so the control parameter is mu. That's what I want to emphasize, filling factor. And it can be changed by 2 things, either the density or the magnetic field. And how does it work? It's easy to think of it in terms of magnetic field, in terms of fixing magnetic field and changing density. Then you'll basically do the following. You'll say, okay, if I put my first electron, it has to go in this Landau level, n equal to 0. And I can keep filling it till I reach n phi. At that point, all the states are taken up in the first Landau level. And then I have to move to the second Landau level. So mu equal to 1 is the filling factor when the first Landau level, labeled by little n equal to 0, gets completely filled. Then you move to the next Landau level, and so on. The other way to think about it is that I have a fixed sample with a fixed number of particles. All experiments are done as a function of field. The reason is they have a fixed sample with some number of electrons, and now you change magnetic field. So let's say I'm sitting in this Landau level. And I am partially, let's assume that I have n electron equal to some number, let's say 500. Okay? So now I can change the magnetic field. And if I change the magnetic field, I change the degeneracy. So I'm not moving, you know, so in other words, things are coming to me. You know, the states are moving into, so let's say I'm sitting here, and let's for a moment increase the magnetic field. So if I increase the magnetic field, I'm increasing the degeneracy. So I have more states getting populated here, which means, let's say I've gone on, and now I'm at like 1,000 states there. So relative to the 1,000 available states, I have only 500 electrons to fill. So this system is going to be a partially filled Landau level. Now, as I start decreasing the magnetic field, the degeneracy will decrease. At some point, it will equal 500. Boom, that's now the filled Landau level. So there are both ways to think about it. The crucial thing is to think of mu as the variable. Okay, now what I want you to see is, so we've been talking about mu equal to, here. So this is mu equal to 1. So now you can see why you get mu equal to 2 at a lower magnetic field. Okay, so let's try to go through that argument. So here is a filling factor of 1 at some magnetic field. What is this term again? It should be magnetic field.
Yeah,
it should be magnetic field. Okay, so filling factor of 1 at this magnetic field. Now let's look at a lower magnetic field, right? You reduce the degeneracy, which means now the number of flux tubes has gone down. So obviously, for the same number of electrons, I need another Landau level to fill up those electrons because the degeneracy has gone down. By degeneracy, I mean the number of flux tubes has gone down. So to fill the same number of electrons, I must now move to the second Landau level and start filling up that. And when that gets filled up, there comes the second plateau. Okay? So now, imagine moving to lower and lower fields. So what I want to discuss today is not the quantum Hall effect. We are done with that. We have some explanation. I want to go to even lower fields around here. And what you start to see here is the lower fields you go to, the more the Landau levels you're going to fill. And so the question is, what is happening to some kind of, you see some little squiggly oscillations there as you go to very low fields. And that's what I want to discuss today. And some of it was discussed actually by Andy, so I want to bring that up now. So in the very low magnetic field region of the integer quantum Hall effect is another kind of oscillatory phenomena sitting there, very much related, but because they are happening at extremely small magnetic fields and very close by, they are hard to resolve. And this is what is called by different names. One name for that is Shubnikov-Dehaas-Van-Alphen effect. So it comes by many names. But when you see oscillations in the resistivity, it's basically called the Shubnikov-Dehaas-Van-Alphen effect. But again, never mind the name. What you want to remember is the origin of all of this is the density of states has a certain periodicity, okay? Life in the first Landau level is very much like life in the second Landau level. And if somebody didn't tell you you were in the 100th Landau level, you wouldn't know, because every Landau level has the same structure. And that's the reason why you will see some kind of oscillation. Okay, so I will show you that in more detail. And the other thing to note is that these oscillations will be, you can either view them as in terms of density or magnetic field. And really the correct variable is mu. So that would suggest that you should be not plotting things as a function of B, but as a function of 1 over B. Because that is where you get in, periodicity with mu. Mu is the controlling the filling. So that's, having said that, let me now show you the... She comes after my class and cleans up the entire computer desktop. Because every time I download things, hoping I'll use it next time, it's been cleaned up. Okay, so here's what Andy did, but let me just show you the very simplest thing. So the very simplest thing is, instead of going to transport, we just look at something even simpler, the energy. We have the density of states, which has the structure. Let's ask, how does this change the energy of the electrons as a function of magnetic field? And that is essentially this sort of a calculation. Yeah. So you want to find the total energy. This is all at zero temperature. So you take epsilon, these epsilons, multiplied by the density of states, and integrate up to the chemical potential. And I won't go through this in detail because I think you probably did it in class, and there is a mathematical notebook on this, which Andy has prepared, which is really nice. what you can show is that essentially what this will involve is adding up the energies of the filled states, and that has this part of the calculation. So you just have n plus half h bar omega c from 0 to n, these are all the filled states, and then taking care of the excess states you need to fill up the rest of the electrons. So you are starting with some fixed n number of electrons, and you are saying nd times m plus 1, which is the states that are getting, the levels that are getting filled. So there are m plus 1 states here. So out of the total n electrons, nd, this nd is the same as my n phi. This is the degeneracy. N phi times m plus 1 have been filled up in these completely filled lambda levels. And the rest of them go into this excess m plus 1 partially filled state. And then you just write your mathematical code for that. And what you find is this, that there is a dependence on the magnetic field. So here's E total as a function of the magnetic field, and you see these oscillations. And as you go to lower and lower fields, these oscillations become harder and harder to resolve. And the reason for that is that the lambda levels are coming very close at lower fields, because the separation between the lambda levels is proportional to the magnetic field. So they're coming very close. If, on the other hand, you take the same information and plot it as a function of 1 over h, which is like our new parameter, then you see, so this is, okay, one more step. So this is the energy. You can also take its derivative and get a susceptibility, okay? A magnetic susceptibility, dEdh. And transport is not quite a susceptibility. This is still a thermodynamic quantity, but transport is very similar. You know, it's a higher order, it's like a higher order effect, but it would involve something more like a susceptibility, some derivative of the energy. And that is shown here, and it has this wiggling behavior. And the next thing what Andy did was to plot it as a function of 1 over h. And you can see now things are becoming periodic in 1 over h. Okay, because 1 over h is essentially tracking mu. And that's when these oscillations become periodic. So this is a classic signature of not just transport, but magnetic field effects in everything. Since it starts with the density of states, it will have an effect in the magnetization, in the energy, all the thermodynamics. It is called by a different name for every single phenomenon. That's what I'm going to do. De Haas van Alphen effect, Shubnikov De Haas, etc., etc. But you know, the main thing is that there is an oscillation of the density of states, magnetization, resistivity, even transition temperature in various systems, all of it originating from the density of states. And the second important point is, look for the oscillations as a function of 1 over the magnetic field, in which case they become periodic, because 1 over the magnetic field is essentially tracking the filling factor. Okay, so, and you know, this is a very nice example of this project. Again, something that came out of our different projects is finding a calculation of this in any book, and we went through so many books, was impossible, right? Mm-hmm. We didn't find this, and you know, then people have tried to do this. This is a classic case where a two-line code is so illuminating compared to forcing it to be done analytically. And there's an absolutely classic book by Abrikosov, who went on to win the Nobel Prize for predicting the vortex in a superconductor. Hardcore analytical person. He has spent in his book about 4 or 5 pages going into the complex plane and all of that to try to get these oscillatory behavior. So, you know, there is hope for many of us. That's how I put it. So, and illumination at the end of the day. Okay, so that sort of wraps up magnetotransport, and it wraps up this entire quarter, basically. So if you have any comments or questions about anything, yeah.
Why were we able to use periodic boundary conditions in X whenever we're applying a voltage overall in that direction?
You can do it even without periodic boundary conditions. It's not so important. It's just to get, because these were plane wave states, right, you want to count them somehow. So when you have, it's like, forget even this problem. When we were just doing free electrons, and we wanted to count how many states we have, the number of states is infinity, right? But if you want to get, so we are talking about the small delta k within the Brillouin zone. So there are length scales that put a cutoff on momentum scales. So when we do, when I just write down epsilon versus k and I write something like this, so there is a length scale A, which is, let's say, some lattice constant, and that puts a cutoff here. And you might ask, is there any discreteness to the k values here? And this discreteness would come from another length putting a cutoff. And that length would be now pi over L. Okay. So it's another length that puts a cutoff. It just allows you to count. There's nothing more than that. And
So what length scale were we looking at here?
So here we are looking at you have a sample size. So in order for me to define an n phi and count the flux, right, I have to say I have a sample of some size. And then I can count the flux and say, okay, B times A over phi naught is n phi. If A is infinity, I don't know how to do my counting. It's just that. But ultimately, everything is related to densities, you see? Finally, you don't need, it's not like A is determining anything. It's just a way of counting. Ultimately, your control parameters are magnetic field, density, phi naught. You know, just like here, when even though we put L, it finally, we would look at, so the way this would enter is we would sum over K. And then, the number of Ks you would have to sum over is infinite, right? Because it's extremely dense. But then we are looking at densities of K points. So there's a 1 over L here. And this goes into D cubed K over, 2 pi cubed. And finally, this volume will go into some energy per unit volume. So ultimately, it will become a density. Yeah.
This is temperature by scanning the magnetic fields. I was just wondering if there's any sort of time dependence in that effect. So you go from one magnetic field strength to the next. Is there a time dependent effect where so the states sort of change where they are? Is there a time dependent effect?
Well, that's a very good question. That is, here they are waiting long enough to go between magnetic fields.
Right.
But that's a very important question in terms of how quickly does a state relax to the next one? Is there some dynamics? These questions in condensed matter are very open questions. Not much has been done in terms of actual dynamics. And these are very hard questions to not only do experiments on, but also to do theory on. And it's particularly important here when there is disorder. Because what you're asking is, what is the current flow pattern in the system? And I will, next quarter, I'll tell you a little bit more what I'll do next quarter, but I will talk, once more, we will bring up the quantum Hall effect at that point, when I talk about edge states. And actually, the current in this quantum Hall state is carried at the edges, and the disorder puddles are in the center. So exactly how current is distributed is a very delicate question. And when you move between magnetic fields, the distribution has to change. So it's not a question that has been explored very thoroughly yet. Okay, any other questions? questions about the course. I mean, I'm going to erase this board so we don't feel like we have to only stick with this topic. Let's do the following. Let's take questions from anywhere in the course, and then in the last some minutes, I'll tell you what I do next one.
So real quick on this topic still.
Yeah.
If the temperature isn't low enough, you just see the straight line.
Yes.
Because the density of states gets blurred out. Is that?
Yes, okay. Exactly. The density of states, two things blur it out. One is disorder, like I was discussing last night. The other is temperature. And once they get blurred, and that's why at the lower magnetic fields, when these levels are even closer, they are even more susceptible to seeing the oscillations. And that's another reason why you found that the plateaus were not all equally at the same temperature. Some plateaus were more flat than others. And usually it will be the plateaus that are seen at higher magnetic fields will be flatter, because then these levels are further apart, they are not interfering with one another. If they are closer by, then you know there's a temperature broadening for each of them. And this is omega C and this is of order KT. And omega C is a very low energy scale. If you go back and put numbers, it's like millivolt scales, typically. So temperature is still lower, but it's like an order of magnitude lower, but it's still on the order of, it's not an EV scale. For one Tesla, it's about, temperature is on the order of millivolts, and magnetic field is also similar energy scales. Okay, so any more questions from the whole course? I mean, at some level, let's see, what all did we, you know, we started with semiconductors, and we've covered a huge number of topics in some sense. The main topics we covered were semiconductors, lattice vibrations, and transport. So broadly, those are the three things. So let's see, other questions you might have, or you could even give me suggestions for what you'd like to see next quarter, whatever. Or phenomena you've heard about and you want to see, understand what is the context with what we did. In a way, this quantum Hall effect brought together semiconductors and many things. You know, so the systems are governed, are basically gallium arsenide doped systems. So, you know, very small ideas from different fields kind of come together. You know, for example, people knew about gallium arsenide and they knew that you can dope it and generate carriers in the conduction band, but the mobilities were terrible. So then this idea came up that you don't need to dope, you can dope far away from gallium arsenide in the other material in between. So you have this is the gallium aluminum arsenide. You can dope this one with silicon, and the electrons will transfer here, so they are far away. And these electrons in the gallium arsenide, which is here, are not seeing the impurities. And that is what allowed people to get a million mobility, million in units of some centimeter square volt per second or something. So, you know, a small idea like that then allowed one to make these very nice samples. And that led to the quantum Hall effect being seen. And then it's just amazing how one thing leads to another. And it almost never stops.
A question on that. So since you're doing these measurements at really low temperature in the semiconductors, so I would expect there will be a freeze-out, the donors will not give away as many carriers, so, but still we say there will be electron gas that we are observing the effects.
Right. So these states are all filled. That's what you're operating with. The valence band is completely filled. Okay? Now when you put electrons here, in the conduction band. So let me not bend any bands right now.
Pardon? The electron you're putting from externally.
Yeah, the electrons are being put externally from silicon. So silicon in this material, you know, usually we think of donors in silicon, like phosphorus or beryllium. Now we are talking about another material, 3,5. So in such a system, silicon is actually the one that acts as a donor of electrons. So silicon donates electrons, but they are donated in the conduction band. So
doped above metal insulator, or?
Yeah, they are doped into the conduction band of the gallium aluminum arsenide. But these are then at higher energy than where they could be. And so they come into these levels. It doesn't quite look like this. Because of the band bending, it will look like this. So this is gallium aluminum arsenide. And this is gallium arsenide. So the electrons don't really sit in this entire well. They sit in this level here, in that triangular potential. If you have done this problem in your quantum mechanics class of a triangular potential, it gives you these airy functions, A-I-R-Y. And that's actually the solution of that kind of a problem. But anyway, the electrons that were here get transported to that point. And at low temperatures, they are just at that level. And the reason this freeze out doesn't happen is that other stuff is all occupied.
No,
here.
Yeah, so silicon itself may not donate electrons because there is not
enough. Right. Actually, I'm not sure about that process. Maybe they first make it go and then reduce the temperature. That's something I'm not sure about. Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah. I don't know whether they... Because I see your point. Your point is at very low temperatures, the donors will be here.
Yes.
So you first need to get the... Or...
Just dump it above metal insulator.
No. Yeah, maybe that's another way. You drive it up, you put enough density that they are above the metal insulator transition. Then they are delocalized. So long as they are bound, they are not going to be able to hop here. So either you have to raise the temperature or you put make the density high. That's a possibility. And then they can come here. Yeah. What else? Any other questions? What kinds of research are you doing? Do you see any connections? So somebody sent in one of the earlier surveys wrote, they are happy to see this course is just completely separate from their research, which is also fine. But it's nice if you start to see connections. And what I would say here is if you start to see connections, try to open the textbook or the notes and kind of start looking a little around there and seeing if you can connect a little more intimately, like, you know, because the research is always very complicated and you are thrust into it right away. Take a bit of time to just kind of connect with the basic concepts you've learned and it'll pay off in a big way. Yeah.
So yeah, along those lines, like we made it to PN junctions and like maybe mentioned FETs or something in that. So like the research I'm involved in, these things are pretty ubiquitous. I kind of have to like sit down and think them through every time. Is there like a next step? Like, do we have like a physics of semiconducting devices course?
You know, it's actually within physics. I think my course has done semiconductors for the first time. When I talked with the previous people who have taught this course, they never even discussed semiconductors. And partly the reason is very interesting. Semiconductors. Became well understood at the level physicists like to understand several years ago. So it kind of moved into electrical engineering. And they are the ones that do extensive semiconductor research. Mm-hmm. Now it's coming back because of this FET geometry. Because you can, you know, FET initially was just like a MOSFET, all semiconducting. But now you can have carbon nanotubes forming the channel. Or you can have a graphene channel. And the FET is just being used as a way to control the density. So it's taken on another life because that has become important. Also, semiconductors themselves have become important in condensed matter again. They were not so important some years ago. And so semiconductors have become important because now people want to study magnetic phenomena in semiconductors. So So that's the reason for the return. So, you know, these things go back and forth. So now, you know, I decided as a result of that to start teaching that. But I would say the next course, maybe people in electrical engineering are better equipped to answer that. What are some of the further courses here?
We have one which is an undergrad level that's just on basic semiconductor devices, like treatment level.
Yeah, it was one of our things.
So it's
right.
Like 432, that's undergrad.
But wouldn't that be at the same level as what we did? Or?
Yeah, so maybe more devices are covered because they only cover devices, they actually don't cover much of physics. That's why I'm here, because we don't study like. And then we have one very advanced course, and I have told the professor we should have some physics course here as a prerequisite for that. That's a company, 32. It's electrostructural devices, high speed. Actually, it covers a lot of transport, postman transport, scattering, and inelastic scattering. I think this course is good for the way it's done this time. So
right.
Before taking it before that course, because that course was difficult for me.
Right.
So that course might be interesting for physics students.
So that's another way. So, you know, basically, what one sees is like Boltzmann transport is almost never used by physicists, okay? Even though I spend so much time on it. And the reason I spend time on it is because it sets the foundation for how you think about it. But the reason we don't discuss Boltzmann transport is usually we are looking at much more complicated systems where, for example, interactions are important. So, you know, if you ask, where are the open questions in physics? They are not at the level of one particle problems. All of what we discussed was, to a great extent, one particle physics. You know, a single electron in some situation. That kind of thing is still important in the context of spin orbit coupling. That's another angle where you can still go on with one electron physics, meaning interactions are not so important, but you have spin and orbit getting coupled within a one electron picture. Besides that, practically everything includes interactions. So the big things in physics that we like to go after are magnetism. And magnetism is dominated by interactions. The origin of magnetism is entirely quantum mechanical and driven by interactions. And then, you know, other things as well. So a lot of Boltzmann transport has also moved into the engineering world. So remember, I tried to show you some data on thermal conductivity of graphene by looking at some mold. And I tried to track down that paper because the paper was not very well written. It didn't kind of explain some things, and we didn't get a chance to talk more about it in the class. But I tracked down the author. Turns out to be somebody in the electrical engineering department at UC Irvine. And they have done detailed, very detailed modeling and all of that. So what one notices is, the moment it goes into the engineering arena, there are detailed modelings and lots of computer simulations and all of that. And then, you know, they can model the actual device. Now, in a course like this, we are more after just trying to get the basic idea and the basic ingredients, you know. So the little bit of Mathematica that we do is all that we go after. We don't use canned codes. And a little bit of that is also reflective of the fact that in our research, except for a lot of work done in density functional theory to look at energy bands, practically there are no standard codes. People develop their own codes for every bit of research. Because it's really at a stage where this knowledge doesn't exist. And as I always say, you know, we create knowledge, see dagger, acting on vacuum. So vacuum and then we create knowledge. So, you know, like these undergrads will ask me, so you know, what's the application of what you do and this and that? And they say, we create knowledge. And they're like, that's good. Creating knowledge. You know, we can create a bomb, but we can also create better things. But anyway, so I hope this gives you some flavor of at least some of the standard stuff. Any other questions? I mean, we have people here from different groups, which has been nice. You know, there's some electrical engineers, mechanical engineers, chemists, and you know, many physicists. And even among the physicists, you all are doing very different things. So next quarter, what I want to do are three different things. One is Landauer transport. And this will connect with what you're talking about, these FECs and so on. So I'm going to do three topics next quarter. First is Landauer. And that's basically trying to understand transport in like nanosystems. And it goes back, yeah, go ahead.
Any relation to Landau?
No, totally different.
Yeah,
no. Landau was from the Russian school. Landauer, I don't know what his origins are, but he was at IBM. He's an American. So, you know, I don't know if he has some Russian roots or something. That I'm not good at this. But he was an IBM. And it actually is a very beautiful way of doing transport, which is why I want to pick up on that next quarter. Because very early on, when we started discussing transport, I asked all of you, how do you think about it? And many of you said, in terms of transmission, you know, you have some system, you bring some electrons, and you ask what fraction got transmitted. Really, that is the core of transport. Somehow in this Boltzmann approach, that idea got lost. But we will bring that in this Landauer transport. It's a very direct way of looking at small systems. So let's say you have electrons in a box. So actually the physics will become totally easy. It'll be so different in this. So you know, you have, let's say, electrons in a box, and everything is nano. So you know, it's like atoms. So it's, you know, how hard can that be? We learned atoms before we did all these solids, but now we go back to atoms. These are now artificial atoms, but so what? It's hard to make them, but it's not hard to model them. So here's a small system, and it's going to have these discrete levels, and you ask, what is the transport through something like this? And you can look at the conductance, and clearly, as you change the chemical potential, you can imagine you will get conductance, then you will get nothing, then you will get conductance, and so on. These papers are, you know, intellect, you know, just understanding it are trivial, because you say, well, you know, you have states and then you don't have states. And so if you look at the conductance, G, as a function of voltage, which is this chemical potential, this is voltage here, so relative to some zero. And then you see conductance doing this. And this has nothing to do with quantum Hall effect. This is just trying to pass something through a channel in which either states exist or they don't exist. And so it has this sort of thing, and each channel brings in a conductance of E squared over H. And so there are, besides this, there are many other interesting effects of what are called Coulomb blockade. Okay, so you're trying to again pass something, but if Coulomb effects are something we have ignored right now, and they will become very important if the system becomes small. You know, like in an atom, we know Coulomb effects are very strong. There are Hund's rules and so on you might have learned in chemistry, which all come from whether or not another electron is allowed to sit in a certain level because of Coulomb interactions. So that becomes important now in these nanosystems, because your wave functions are very confined, Coulomb effects are enhanced, and that can affect transport. So we will talk about that. And it leads to some very interesting devices, single electron transistors, Josephson qubits, etc. So that's like one part. And then the second part, I'm going to talk about superconductivity. Now, this is another topic which comes and goes. So when I was in graduate school, you know, John Wilkins, he was one of my teachers at that time. And he taught me condensed matter physics, and he said, oh, no point learning superconductivity, it's all done deal. It's all solved, the DCS theory wrote the last paper on it, and, you know, full stop. So we never even learned superconductivity. And the year I was graduating, high TC superconductivity was discovered. And, you know, there's been no stopping after that. So this topic is back. Now, high TC is all over. I shouldn't say all over. It's all over in terms of, you know, the major thrust. It's still there. It's still unsolved. And maybe one of you will solve it one of these days. But it is taking on many new roles in terms of, again, connecting with this topic. So you can make Josephs and qubits. And to understand that, we have to basically understand some aspects of superconductivity. Moreover, superconductivity is a very good example for any kind of phase transition, which has a continuous order parameter. So, you know, you've done Ising models with discrete order parameters. This is a very prototypical example to understand continuous order parameters and how you get phase transitions of that. And also, it's a very good way to understand defects and vortices, which are very important in all of these nanosystems. So superconductors is a good way to understand all of that. So continuous order parameter. So in a way, I won't just be talking about superconductivity, but more generally about a huge class of problems that share the same thing. Continuous order parameter and phase transitions. And the second thing is topological defects. And this topic actually could have come up even in the crystal structures we crystals we talked about, because, you know, we talked about perfect crystals and all this Bravais lattice and all that. And then as you heat it, we talked about phonons. But then, you know, if you disturb it even more, you can start to get dislocations and other kinds of extended defects. And those are what are called topological defects. We didn't use that word because it's all a bit complicated in the crystal language. But that same idea we will pick up here and talk about these defects. And then, you know, so on. And then the third topic I want to bring up is Coulomb interactions. I will start with very simple things like, so I'm going to look at, these are, so you know, up to here we are talking about non-interacting electrons, then there is a little bit of interaction. I might change the order of these two, and both of these talk about interactions. These are attractive, these are repulsive. So that will be kind of the theme. And I'll talk about some very interesting developments here with plasma oscillations, which, you know, happen in a metal. You can separate the positive and negative charges and let it go, and they will oscillate like a mode. But now, in the context of, again, nanosystems, these oscillations can be very interesting. On a gold particle, you can get plasma oscillations, and this is having a huge impact right now. You know, we don't discuss these impacts in detail, but essentially people are using these small gold dots. You can attach a little DNA and send it, you know, DNA is addressable. So you can tell DNA to go to a particular location in the body, unlike just eating a pill, which spreads everywhere uniformly. So you can send this DNA to a particular site, like a cancer site. And then if you irradiate it with a particular frequency at the plasma frequency radiation, that gold particle will absorb the energy and get hot and kill that cancer cell. You know, sounds dramatic. But it all comes from the properties of a single small particle and its oscillations. So again, that kind of thing is what I'm talking about in the third part, or maybe I'll switch to the second one.
Topic, Coulomb interactions, is that largely in the context of like magnetism?
Yeah. Magnetism and these density oscillations. I won't do magnetism per se. I will do some spin transport here. So here I should also add spin transport. spin transport will come up again and again, because you know, once we understand density of states in the superconductor, you can make these tunnel junctions of different materials. So you know, these topics will kind of interact with each other. This topic and this topic are related at some level, because you make tunnel junctions with different kinds of materials, magnetic and superconducting, magnetic and oxides, and so on. But I won't do magnetism per se. By that I mean atomic magnetism, you know, all that, you know, different mechanisms, because there is another course on that. And I don't know how often it will be taught, but there is another course. Any other thoughts, questions? Yeah, I know you guys have filled out that questionnaire, but is there something that I should know that is of critical importance? I won't see them for like months and months. So as I plan the next quarter, is there something you'd like me to change? Because you know, this will impact us in 2 weeks. I'll be frantically working through the spring break, you can see. This is not a course I've taught before, so. I mean, at least not the, not topic 1 and 3. So this is my way of teaching it to myself. But as I plan that, are there some, is there some feedback from this course you would like me to implement immediately or change something so that it's done? First of all, I should ask, how many of you will take the course next quarter? Ah, then you all have to give me feedback right now. At least the parts you would like me to change. Because what if I did the same thing? Then you're forced to. Eric, you should speak up, because
okay.
you should be able to tell me yes.
So
I'm putting
it on the spot. Just a general comment.
Yeah.
None of these topics are covered in Ashcroft and Merman.
Yeah. No.
So will you provide references for?
For all of it. Yeah. And the references are going to be, so now this is where things get hard. Last time I tried this, I had a lot of negative feedback. I had listed some 7 books, and I said, you know, I'm not going to look at Ashcroft and Merman, that's out of the window, you know, I studied from that, and it can't be the same. And I said, it'll be from one of these 7 books. People didn't like that, because I was not able to mention at any one point in time which book I had taken what from. Because when I wrote my notes, I would look at all the 7 of them would be on my big dining table, and I would be kind of flowing between them, and then, you know, grasping them and writing my own notes. So it got very, when people said, where did you take it from? And I couldn't remember. From that experience, now I keep track of it. So I will, the references may not all be in a book, but they might be in a paper, and I will attach it with every lecture note. I have tried to be good about my lecture notes, you have to admit that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That took a lot of work on my part. My lecture notes are not that way the first time they come out. So I have to write and rewrite, and I don't have the ability to tech it, because my teching is slow. So even if I rewrite it 3 times, I'm still maybe an order of magnitude faster than writing it. So that's a problem. I didn't learn typing in my, saddled with having to write it 3 times. Or at least 2. And okay, that's a very mild comment, but anything. Andy, you tell me.
So actually on the topic of lecture notes, I have a hard time learning from quickly scoping PDFs. Like when we put them up on the screen.
Yes, yes.
And then they end up scattered, like we have to go there or sort through in my notes to kind of not centralized. I don't know if there's a good solution to this, because I know it's sort of a time constraint.
No, so tell me again, what, just read, no, I don't mean it, I will not go through the notes on the, I won't scroll through them in the class.
Okay.
I will be writing lectures on the board, as I usually do.
Okay.
Occasionally, if something is not so important, I scroll.
Right.
And that, I don't expect you to be taking in every little bit there. But you know, basically, I like the blackboard style, no matter what, because it just slows you down and the information is coming at the right place. So I'm not going to give up that. This is the lecture notes that I post after the lecture.
Right.
That's what I'm talking.
Okay, then I agree with that.
Okay.
Approach.
Is this blackboard thing working for everyone? Yeah. More or less. Rick, you're struggling, so.
Maybe by shorting.
Means
no
yes. Okay. Any other comment?
I know it might be hard, but if, I feel like if we had smaller homework assignments more often, that it might get us in doing the problems as going throughout, because I feel like we go 3 weeks without homework.
Yeah.
And there's like 3 problems and it's hard to do it with the rest of my homework. So if there was like one problem a week or something like that.
That's a good idea. I will try to do that. So maybe after every, is this Wednesday format working for people? I mean, we practically had the same number of classes, I counted, just to see that did we do more than the total number? Because at some point I wasn't counting. Last year I had really counted. This year it got a little chaotic and I didn't count, but I checked. And we have done the same number of lectures with all my traveling. But is this working format, Wednesday, or? No other alternative, really, because, I cannot, because I have so much traveling, I cannot expect any of my colleagues to take the class. And now with these topics, nobody will. Maybe superconductivity people will, but, then I have to pay back. And then, where is the time to pay back? So,
along the lines of the homework comment, the assessments, if they could be more timely, that'd be helpful. Because we basically took semiconductors after phonons and then phonons after.
So I think we need to get that a little more in the gear. So a homework every 2 lectures. So how about that? Every 2 lectures, we do a small homework. And then we discuss it in class. I used to find that discussions in class took a lot of time, but we don't have to discuss everything, just the salient points. And I think that has been helpful, right? Saying, okay, this is how you would put a defect, this is how you would do something else, and then going on, okay? So I will make a note of that, have a little more timely assessment and feedback and all of that. So I think it might be helpful if I just devote Wednesday to more of a tutorial setting, where we go through more of problem solving and so on.
Yeah, or at least discussing the salient points in the homework. Because I think it comes through a lot better when we work on it and then talk about it again.
Right, so how about if you guys promise me the following? Tuesday I give you, partly this disconnect happens because you guys don't do the homework. Now let me say from my side, you guys don't do the homework until like 0 minus. Of the due date. So what will help is, I give you the homework on Tuesday, you read at least and try a bit. Wednesday we discuss salient points. Thursday you submit. How about that?
Well,
2 days, they will be short ones. Then you recover on the weekend. No.
Offset that.
Yeah.
The core classes have their.
Right. Okay. So let's offset that. I agree.
Yeah,
so Tuesday, I give the problem. Or rather, let's say, you can submit on next Tuesday.
Tuesday.
And then the Wednesday when we turn it in, or the Tuesday we turn it in,
I don't know.
Discuss it that next day or that day.
Or how about Thursday I give you a problem?
Yeah.
And then weekend you try. Wednesday we have a discussion in class.
Yeah.
Salient points. And then Thursday it's due. Is it too late to have the salient point discussion on a Wednesday then? Is it like it's due the next day?
Well, that's what I'm saying. Have the discussion after it's due. And then we just ask you for help.
After it's due? I thought
no.
I'm fine with that.
Okay.
Most people need the discussion before.
People can disagree with me. Okay.
So let's have salient point discussion before, Wednesday.
Okay.
Thursday you submit, and then we try to have the homework graded on the weekend, and Tuesday we return, and we quickly have a discussion on Tuesday. So you had.
So that's two discussions.
Two discussions.
About the
one after and one, so short ones. Short, and I try to use as much by saying, this stuff is discussed in notes which are added on the web. Or even after the homework, only discuss the 2 points that everyone had trouble with. Because we have to save some time.
That's always ambitious.
Yeah, very ambitious. And you know, with me, you know, I come in and I'm not in the mood sometimes. I do not want to touch the homework. Because now I have been thinking about, you know, my own thought processes are very different. Because stuff like the quantum Hall effect, you know, you think it's been around for so many years. No good succinct description in any book. It's very interesting. That's why I feel as information gets more and more complex, the way we process information will become so important. And people who are able to keep a few things in their mind well, I think will become successful, will dominate. Because there's, you know, there's Wiki. And Wiki is great, but you still need to know. Like yesterday when I tried to find that oscillatory thing, you know, I was like trying to think, okay, how to zero in? And you know, I got that Physics Today article right away. Because I'm thinking, okay, how to go through this mess of information? So that's what is happening. It's there. But how do you navigate? So even things like, so that's why there's this last thing I will let you go after this, is a wiki book that I'm putting together. And you know, some of you guys may, you know, your approach and all that might actually flow into that. And part of the reason for that wiki book is I want to get answers to why are there bans. I don't want to read like 20 pages to figure out, you know, all the bans. I want a quick answer. And Wiki does that. You know, you go there and it says something. And so the book that I want to try to put together, so next quarter I'm teaching, the quarter after that, I'm off teaching. And I'm basically working on my book. And the book will have this sort of format where there will be concepts and there will be these mathematical modules, and it'll be a much more interactive book, where people can take that mathematics and play with it on their own. And the same thing with data. You know, like we talked about specific heat. And you know, there's one like me, I can show you some, you know, data from some references. But you know, they, for example, they may plot specific heat as a function of temperature, and okay, it's T cubed. And they'll say something like T cubed. Now, it's useful if we could just grab that data and make a file in Mathematica, let's say, and say, well, I want to plot this as CE over T versus T, and then now it's going to go like some T squared. And the reason for that is the integral under this curve is equal to the entropy. And so I can get the entropy. So if you want to do anything like that, you know, I illustrate these things in the class, but we are not able to do that with real data because that data is stagnant. You can't just pull it on and off and easily.
Have you heard of data thief?
Yeah, data thief. You have to do one of these grabber data thief, one of these digitizers. But you know, that's like a huge amount of work to try to do that. And this data should be available in a textbook. You know, a textbook has to be a live object. You know, it's not like some static object. You should be able to pull the data and say, I want to plot it like this. I'd like to see what the entropy is as a function of temperature, and so on. So that's the kind of, that's what this book will have. It will have live data, and then you know, we derive low temperature specific heat and high temperature. Well, let's fit it to the actual experimental curve and see how far we can go with that asymptotic expansions. So you know, it becomes much more exciting when you are checking your theory against experiments. And as far as I can see, there's no such book. And I don't want to write a static book, you know, like just by in principle. It's a dynamic book and it has to be changeable. So there's no point putting it in print. Somebody asked me, how are you going to make money? And I said, I need to figure that out. I haven't thought about that. But if anyone has ideas on the business angle where I'm sorely lacking, but I do want to make money. I just don't know how to. And I would like to. So if you have ideas, you know, let me know. We can have a partnership here.
What's the role of presentations next quarter? Similar to this quarter? Or?
Tell me, did you guys like them or not? I can have a show of hands. How many people, you know, let's first ask, like giving them, and how many people like listening to them? These are two separate things. So, you know, because let's say I have a fantastic presentation, I enjoy giving that. I think, oh, everyone's presentation just is terrible, and I have to sit through that. So it depends on how the whole thing was, a good or a bad experience. What did you think? How many people enjoyed making it and learned from it enough for the time that it took them? Okay. So, and how many people enjoyed listening to them? Some not going up, okay. Okay. Okay, so I don't know, we have to think. So it looked like there was a majority on both sides, so we could go with presentations at some level. So maybe the best thing is to find out why people did not like giving them and why people did not like listening to them. And there might be some things we can improve on that front. So there's not enough time now, but we can do that later. But yeah, I think we will have presentations. Maybe in some other format. We could do it in a more painless format where we devote like a conference and there's a sharp cutoff and then we just move on. That's another way. And in such forums, I do provide pizza, so. Okay, well, thanks for the corner, and all the best for the spring.